When we're here today, taking part in this, in these presentations, I think Action Canada is a great way to get a lot of ideas together and get people thinking about policies. But really, ultimately, what makes a difference is acting on these things. So I know I will, and I encourage everyone else here to be thinking about, okay, what does this mean? What can I do after today, after this Action Canada year, to actually make these things happen? Because that's really where the leverage and the impact is going to happen.
We are the French group. I'm going to start in French. I hope you guys are ready. Le 12 juin 2014, quelque chose d'extraordinaire s'est passé, peut-être à l'insu de beaucoup de gens, mais qui est en train de révolutionner les industries dans le monde. Le constructeur de véhicules électriques Tesla a posé un geste inusité en offrant gratuitement ses brevets à la concurrence. Le PDG de Tesla, Elon Musk, disait à ce propos, des entreprises qui dépendent de leurs brevets, c'est qu'ils n'innovent pas ou ils n'innovent pas assez rapidement. Beaucoup d'observateurs ont traité ça de fou, partager ses brevets à la concurrence. Mais cela est une tendance qu'on est en train d'observer au plein d'autres compagnies. Et aujourd'hui, nous aimerons partager cette réflexion sur l'innovation et voir la place du Canada, l'avenir du Canada, en intégrant l'innovation comme élément essentiel du développement. De nos jours, les brevets servent-ils simplement à étouffer l'innovation, le progrès? Est-ce que les brevets servent à consolider les positions des grandes entreprises dominantes, à enrichir les juristes plutôt que les inventeurs? Ce sont des questions essentielles pour penser à la propriété intellectuelle, aux brevets et à l'innovation. Alors, bienvenue dans le monde de l'innovation ouverte. Chers invités, chers collègues d'Action Canada, c'est un grand plaisir pour moi et pour mes collègues d'être ici à Vancouver, les territoires ancestraux des Squamish, Musqueam et Tsleil-Waututh. Aujourd'hui, à travers ce dialogue public, nous souhaitons raffiner notre compréhension des défis et problématiques liés à la collaboration entre entreprises et à l'innovation ouverte. Et votre collaboration active, votre participation active lors de la discussion va influencer le rapport que nous sommes en train de rédiger et qui sera présenté en février 2016.
Open innovation would be the idea that organizations should make much greater use of external ideas and technologies in their own innovation activities on the one hand. On the other hand, a lot of their own internal unused ideas and technologies should be allowed to go outside for others to use as well.
So it's a question of both inside out and outside in.
That's correct.
Now, can you give us a few examples to illustrate it?
Philips would be a classic example of a company that has really transformed itself. Prior to 2003, they had this high-tech campus of about 1,500 engineers and scientists gathered together on a square kilometer of real estate behind barbed wire with one entrance and very careful security. And the idea was to keep the ideas in and keep them from getting out. In 2003, they had their own Berlin Wall moment where they tore down all the fencing, literally opened up the campus, and today, instead of 1,500 people, there are more than 7,000 people. So this entire high-tech campus has been turned into an ecosystem of innovation instead of a guarded repository of Philips' own ideas.
As the Chief Policy Advisor for Innovation Saskatchewan pointed out, in Saskatchewan, collaboration with your neighbor is essential because if you don't work together, you both freeze your first winter. In almost 30 interviews that we conducted in our research, however, several interviewees highlighted how Canadian businesses aren't collaborating. Franca Scubes, who works for an open innovation company in both Montreal and France, pointed out that 95% of his company's business is in France and only 5% in Montreal. David Naylor pointed out that governments might give a nod to open innovation, but it remains rhetoric and few actions are taken. And a policymaker for the Newfoundland government pointed out that while companies might be good at networking, they're not good at collaborating, and collaboration involves a much higher level of engagement. In the nearly 50 respondents we had to both our questionnaire and our interviews, we were given a variety of explanations as to why Canadian companies aren't collaborating. Government is an issue, government getting in the way, policies or the lack thereof, organizational culture within companies, or simply a lack of capacity. Yet everyone we spoke to agreed that collaboration is increasingly becoming key not only to innovate, but to compete and survive as a company. One of our former fellows who works in the mining industry said the problems in his sector are so big and so complex that no one company can come up with the solutions. They need to be working together to come up with those solutions. So some Canadian companies are adopting an open innovation approach. And I'll give you a few examples of some companies or organizations that are doing this successfully. One of them is the Ontario Brain Institute. So they bring together researchers, they fund research projects that force researchers from completely different fields to work together and to share their databases. So for example, researchers working in autism are working with researchers who are working in Alzheimer's, and they've come up with solutions that they wouldn't have if they had worked separately. They also bring in entrepreneurs from outside the organization and integrate them into their research project to allow these entrepreneurs to test their products or therapies within a research project and move those towards commercialization. Government is also realizing increasingly the importance of open innovation to encourage more innovation in the country. At the federal level, there's the Building Canada program. That's a program where small businesses can apply, come to government with a product or service, and have a government agency or ministry test their product or service, get feedback on it, and eventually bring it to a wider market.
Now I think it's time to talk to, well, to hear from our two panelists we've brought from both sides of the country. From my perspective, they're on the right side. David's from Vancouver, René's from New Brunswick. So I'll just read a little bio for both of them. René Boudreau is Executive Director for Research and Innovation at the Government of New Brunswick. In this capacity, he works closely with stakeholders, government departments and agencies, as well as research and innovation players in New Brunswick. David Eves is a public policy entrepreneur, open government activist and negotiation expert. He's retained by several governments to advise on open government and open data. He also advises businesses and nonprofits on open source strategies and community management. He is an affiliate with the Berkman Center for Internet and Society at Harvard, where he is looking at issues surrounding the politics of data, as well as how negotiation theory can help improve online community engagement.
Well, first of all, thanks for the invitation. It's great to be here in Vancouver. C'est génial d'être avec un groupe de penseurs et de leaders comme vous pour parler d'un sujet qui, moi, me passionne beaucoup. Aujourd'hui, je vais parler de gouvernance à deux vitesses. Moi, je suis comme un drôle de parcours. Je suis un étudiant de sciences politiques et de philosophie qui est maintenant considéré comme au sein du gouvernement comme l'expert au niveau des technologies de l'information. Je ne suis pas certain comment ça a arrivé, mais il y a tout un parcours qui s'est développé autour de ça. Aujourd'hui, je vais vous parler de la gouvernance à deux vitesses. Vous savez, comme étudiant de sciences politiques, ça fait à peu près une dizaine d'années que j'ai décidé que le système Westminster n'allait pas être réinventé, puis qu'il fallait plutôt trouver des workarounds. So that's a realization I made a few years ago now, and we need to figure out ways to innovate within the systems we have. So just like the corporate world, where a large player like GE needs to grow and get innovative through acquisitions, government needs to get a lot smarter about how we build the same type of model, because innovating the general apparatus will require more nimble ways of going about it. And that's a concept that both externally within our relationship with the economy, but also internally, that's quickly gaining ground across both corporate Canada and the public sector. That is bimodal governance, certainly in technology adoption. So we can't let go of our legacy systems, so we will make policy like we've made policy 95% or 90% of the time. We will make certain decisions like we've always made those decisions 90% of the time because the systems require it. We need a certain level of stability to kind of drive our main line of business. But on the margins of that, we need to be able to build those innovation ecosystems that allow us to pull in new ideas. You can go ahead. So I've got the best job in the world, which I think anyway, a job I was able to create for myself actually. So I'm executive director of research and innovation in something called the Jobs Board in New Brunswick. It's essentially the cabinet's economic advisory committee. So we work for the premier. There's four of us. There's a chief economist, chief of business relations, myself on the innovation file, and our CEO. And we provide policy advice up. And what my real title is, or at least the one I think I have, is my job is to disrupt our different business lines. So I do a lot of work with the research and innovation community. So your typical kind of research to commercialization, work with the venture capital bodies, etc. But where I really have a lot of fun is when I engage with the different deputy ministers on trying to en essayant de créer de la zizanie au sein de leur ministère pour tenter de les forcer à réinventer certains de leurs programmes, certaines de leurs approches. So il y a OK, c'est génial. Non, c'est parfait. Ce qui est génial avec l'innovation ouverte et les nouvelles technologies, c'est que ça nous permet d'aller chercher des gens qui sont prêts à solutionner des problèmes, mais surtout d'aller chercher des gens qui sont passionnés. So there's a lot of unused capacity out there, both in terms of policy making and in terms of economic development ideas that we can actually tap in through new technologies that we've never had before. So the first key for success in the examples I'll give you is passionate people. I think the experts are on a decline right now across our society, within government, right? So the world where the public servant is the most knowledgeable source of information to provide advice to his minister is disappearing very quickly because of the forces that are at play. So it's figuring out how you tap into very passionate people, not always the typical experts you'd have. The second step is how do you create spaces on the margins of those large systems that we have to be able to test out new ideas and to be able to minimize risk. Governments are extremely risk adverse, more than any corporation out there, or at least maybe not the large ones, but we have very low tolerance because of how we interact with the media, how our ministers, so we need to create those safe spaces for everyone to collaborate in. And then the step three is provide them with access to problems, because we have problems. Certainly in New Brunswick, I don't know about the rest of Canada, but we've got a series of huge economic issues, puis des problèmes de politique publique qui sont what I'd call wicked problems that we can't solve by ourselves. And then create a market for those ideas that can scale. So those lessons apply both in the private sector and in the public sector. So if you seed an ecosystem of ideas, you need a willing buyer. Now, in the corporate world, it's making sure that those acquisition models have both the venture capital and the large companies ready to acquire those ideas. For the public sector, it's about having a government that's willing, once an idea is proven, to buy into it. So we tried to figure out, how do you transform government technology? We have legacy systems. Donc, on a des systèmes au gouvernement qui sont périmés. On a investi dans des grosses solutions. Le back-end est très désorganisé. Nos bases de données sont... Je pense que c'est la réalité à travers la Fédération canadienne. NB Plus a été créé, NB Plus, qui est essentiellement un partenariat où we have executives in residence, essentially. So the companies all pitched in their own money, and these are all small SMEs. They're not necessarily your typical, you know, the EYs or the Deloittes and others that we'd work with as a government. A bunch of small SMEs committed, you know, a lot of billable hours to this. And on our end, we committed our best people too. And what we're trying to create is the notion of government as a platform. And it's the same thing. We've got problems. We've got a back end that looks like the back ends of governments across the world. And we need to figure out ways to clean it, and they need to figure out ways to create value. And that's a win-win situation for both of us. So these companies will be coming in completely for free. It's their own investment, right? We're not paying anything. Government is backing away from any IP ownership. So we're saying, if you create something of value behind the curtain, because they'd be having access to the healthcare data, toutes sortes de services comme ça. So si tu peux venir au sein du gouvernement, trouver un produit ou un service au niveau de l'analyse des soins de santé, par exemple, pour mieux déterminer les taux de récidive du cancer ou quelque chose comme ça, then awesome, and you get to take that idea, build it in the lab, test it out, and if it works, you get to take it out and sell it to the world. The government doesn't guarantee it'll buy it. It's your typical kind of startup model, But if we like it, we'll buy it too. And if we don't, then you get to sell it to other people if they want to buy it. Donc, on veut créer un environnement plus ouvert pour pouvoir transformer la façon dont on utilise, la façon dont on fait nos, dont on crée nos services. So that's the second way we're trying to use an open innovation.
If you think about innovation as a big space, open innovation is a slice of that, and it's actually quite easy to get confused between innovation in general and open innovation in specific. And I kind of want to make sure that we tease that out a little bit, and I might mention some examples or kind of talk about some examples that have been mentioned. What I think gets people excited about kind of open innovation is that it presents potentially some new ways of kind of how organizations can innovate and organize themselves and structure their work. And I think kind of at the where this scales up, and when you think about how this is happening at a large organization, I think of my friend Mike Belsner, who's now with Facebook, but used to be with Mozilla, and he was the UX lead. So he was kind of a developer. He ran a section of Mozilla, which is the company that creates Firefox, the web browser. And then he'd have like a development team that worked around him that was composed of maybe like, you know, a couple hundred people, 120 people. But then there were daily contributors, people who showed up, who contributed code to Firefox, and they kind of numbered in the hundreds per day. And there were weekly contributors who were in the thousands. And then there were beta testers, of which there were 500,000. And then there were your daily user base, which at the time was about 450 million people worldwide. It's like amazing to think that you can be delivering a product that's kind of core infrastructure for the internet that's being used on a daily basis by 450 million people with merely kind of a kind of a group of people at the time that was quite small, kind of in the hundreds of people who were actually employed for you, but relying on a group of volunteers who are contributing their time and energy. And the reason, again, that they're able to do so is because not just because people were sharing or collaborating, but rather that the actual underlying code itself was made open, and so there was no permission and no license that required them to kind of be signed on or authenticated in order to go do that. And the other nice thing is sometimes that community, and I use that word very specifically, would do things that you wouldn't anticipate, and that can have good or bad things. But on the good side, when Firefox 1.0 launched, people didn't know how to promote it, and so a group of people got together and said, if you give us $5, we'll buy the biggest ad we can in the New York Times. And what they ultimately created was, I think, a two-page spread, and it's composed, it's the logo composed of all the names of people who donated like very small amounts of money to make that ad possible. The other cool thing about Mozilla is that at the time, it was really a response to Microsoft Explorer, which was dominant in the market, and it ran a real risk of controlling how the web would evolve. And in many ways, it was actually an emergent citizen-led consumer response to a regulatory crisis. So an example of how a group of citizens could do something that actually governments were unwilling or unable to do. And I think the thing that allows that, as many people here would know, is kind of the methodologies around open source, which is where, again, you have a way for people to come and work together because the tools that they're working on, the things that they're working on, are not owned by a single person, but actually are kind of collectively shared. And that allows the innovation to take place on top of it. And there's really two key components that are coming together. The first is that there's a legal platform that gives a security that people know that anything that they contribute, the ideas that they contribute, are not going to be taken and owned by somebody else, but rather are going to go into a collective pool that they're allowed to exploit, but so is everybody else. And then the second is that there's actually a community that forms that has norms and has a culture and has values that enable that work to take place. And that you can actually nail one of these and not nail the other one, and it will probably fail. And so there's been a lot of effort by many different organizations out there to find ways for people to actively state that they don't own something. And then those different ways have different rules which shape the type of communities that build around them, and so you have different types of licenses that allow different types of people to kind of say the degree of which they're willing to share. So on the far side there, the very restrictive types, they make things where they say, once I own something, if you innovate on top of it, you have to use the same rules of ownership, which means like nobody owns it, as everybody else. So the moment you innovate on top of this, your things are all open as well. Whereas on the right side, they can say, I don't want to own any of this. Anyone can innovate on top of it. But if you create an idea on top of it, you can still own it and make it copyrighted or apply a patent to it. And so these are various ways that you can force the players in your ecosystem to either abide by your rules or to choose their own rules that they want to abide by. And so in these types of organizations, it's not like there's a large hierarchy where ultimately everybody can, you know, there's a manager who kind of says, you're going to do what I say, and if you don't, you're going to be fired. There's a much, much more difficult way of figuring out how decisions get made. And I think one of the key things in these communities is that the social capital is their total capital. And though figuring out how to manage that social capital, how to set the culture and the norms is really important to their success. And in pursuit of that, I kind of want to note what I think are three myths of open innovation that I think a lot of people have when they think about the work that goes on at Mozilla or the work that goes on in these types of open communities. The first is that somehow these communities are meritocracies. The most important thing to actually first know is the word meritocracy is actually derived from a piece of satire, which mocks the very notion that a meritocracy can exist. Really, it's all about the people who all get chosen feeling smug and good about the fact that they got chosen, but not really willing to recognize there's a whole bunch of rules that are skewed in their favor to allow them to be chosen. And if you really want to kind of understand this stuff well, there's a wonderful piece by a second wave feminist called The Tyranny of Structurelessness, which I think is one of the things that actually ends up challenging a lot of open innovation communities, which is that in a world where you say there are very few rules, that's often not the case. There are all sorts of hidden rules that are out there, and when you don't make those rules explicit, it's hard for newcomers to show up and understand what those rules are, and so it rewards those who have been in the community for a long time because they understand the secret rule set, and they don't understand the hidden rule set, and the newcomers don't, and they get punished. So one of the things that I think a lot of open innovation has to do really well is make the rules and the norms that guide that community really transparent to people. Otherwise, you end up creating kind of two classes of citizens, those who understand the way the culture works and those who don't, and inevitably punishes those who don't understand how it works. The second is that open innovation, and I would argue actually innovation in general, is about collaboration. I actually think it's the very opposite. The thing that has made open in a kind of open source community successful is their, especially the most successful ones, is their ruthless drive to actually destroy the need for collaboration whenever possible. Collaboration is a very sticky and challenging process where, like, it's beautiful. It's like thesis and antithesis comes together. Something new emerges out of that that neither one of the parties could have ever imagined. It's this amazing process, but it's also very time consuming and it's very, very challenging. And what open source communities do well is they actually try to find ways to destroy the need for that. Like if you look at something like the Firefox web browser, all of those bugs that I mentioned, all of the problems that need to get solved, they don't pull everybody into a room and do a big committee meeting to figure out how to solve them. What they do is they post them all and they say, can you go and solve this problem? And I get to grab one of those problems and run off on my own or with a group of people that I trust and know and that I get along with, solve that problem. And the genius of the system is it allows me to come back and slide that solution back into a hole without anybody's permission, and it just works. You know, open innovation is it's as much about culture and community as about innovation. That you know these communities thrive when the norms get figured out right. And you can see all sorts of open innovation that breaks down, like in the academic community where the academics don't share data, they don't work together, and it's not because there's no legal mechanism for them to do that, it's that the culture of engagement and sharing has broken down. The norms and the rules that allow for trust have broken down. The final thing I just say is, again, open innovation is not some kind of like utopia creating thing where, you know, people are going to work together on problems that are going to make the world better. You can't actually control what people are going to do with the creations that you make and the ideas that you have. And for me, the kind of ultimate example is this. This is a congressional district in Chicago. This is very clearly a congressional district that's been designed with a very specific purpose in mind. Someone has figured out where the Republicans or the Democrats live, and they've decided they're going to build a congressional district that puts them all in one place so that you can create an outcome. This is only made possible if you have census data that's been made public. This is a wonderful example of innovation. In fact, it's potentially an example of open innovation because they took an open data set, which was the census, and then they crafted a policy that created an outcome that they really wanted to create using that data. So don't for a second believe that kind of like more like openness and more information, more data is going to somehow lead to better outcomes. It simply leads to different outcomes and allows people to do more. And you want to be thinking about who you're rewarding and who you're empowering and who you're not. But don't be under illusions that somehow like this is all going to lead to evidence-based public policy. This is what evidence-based public policy looks like. We took evidence, we had a policy, we wanted an outcome, and we created it. So this isn't about creating utopia, it's about creating some different models, and we gotta like figure out how to make those models work.
If you would like to comment on anything we're gonna talk about the next little while.
When you actually get to public data that actually becomes more private, so I'm in the healthcare sector, which is probably the most inefficient aspect of public service in all of Canada, we have huge mounds of data which could be incredibly useful for improving care, improving outcomes, and lowering cost. But our problem is that it's private or very sensitive data. But the best thing ever would be to open it up to all these entrepreneurs, all these innovators, to have a Mozilla type of topic to get people to mine this and find the efficiencies. I was wondering if either of you might have an idea of how this could actually happen.
Right, there's ways to let people interact with their systems to derive value. Just the culturally, the role of protector of data, the custodian role of civil service, is so strong that it almost shuts down any project before it even starts. So the way we're trying to do it is we're trying to bring them behind the tent using the typical, RFPing some of that so that they're covered through the confidentiality so that they can come behind, but the companies in our case aren't paying, we're just RFPing because we need to RFP to get them behind the curtain. And we're letting them play internally like we would any other contractor that's working on our healthcare databases. Now, that's one way of doing it. I'd much rather do it the open way, and that's what we're trying to explore, is ways to put the fields over the fence with some dummy data in them to allow people to do some work. The other piece that's been done is the Manitoba example that's now going across the country is finding these universities to play third-party roles as custodians of data in terms of some of the most sensitive things. So Manitoba was a leader in that. Most provinces are now pushing their healthcare databases out into universities, into very secure areas, and letting the researchers get their hands on it, following the ethics review, and like a lot more red tape, essentially, to get around the data. I don't know, David, you've probably...
We have a similar thing in British Columbia around the healthcare data, and you know, I'm quite nervous about... I would never say you should be putting healthcare data out there. It's great to look, again, you gotta be careful. Like for every example of Mozilla, there's an example of creating a congressional district that looks like that, and there's like, you know, and designing spam software to like circumvent spam filters so that, you know, we can like destroy everybody's inbox. Like, you know, you can't selectively say, oh, there's the good outcomes without thinking about also the bad outcomes.